Good evening, friends. Welcome to this evening session of the EduSat session on the topic Industrial Productivity in India. This topic is covered in your course EEC 07, which is an elective course in your BDP program. There are in fact two units on which the matter concerning this specific topic chosen is discussed in your blog, and I will be briefly covering the contents of both these units in this short session of 45 minutes. As you have seen, the topic chosen is Industrial Productivity in India. The topic should arise a question in our mind as to why we ought to be interested in the aspect of industrial productivity. And how can we know what are the various things that are required to know whether the industrial productivity in the country is moving in the desired direction or not, is increasing or is growing or not. In order to understand this, it is necessary for us to know, first of all, how we measure productivity, and even before that, what we understand by the concept of productivity, and definitionally, if you dissect that term or concept, what data requirements you need to measure it. Let us see step by step, and to begin with, we can start by understanding in the last 50 years of Indian independence, what has been the policy of the government and how industrial production and industrial growth has been accorded a central place in the planning process of our country. You know very well from your study of Indian economy in general, that there are three major sectors into which the different sectors in the economy is trifurcated. The first is the primary sector, the second is the secondary sector, in which the primary sector basically relates to all those sectors of activity which concerns itself with the production from the raw materials obtained from the natural resources, in which land becomes the primary resource. But in the secondary sector, the products, the materials which are so obtained from the primary sector are subjected to some form of processing or manufacturing by which the value addition is increased. It is to this sector that we will be particularly focusing in our topic today. Even then, if we look at the third sector, the services sector, we are now aware that in the contribution of in the sector wise contribution to the GDP, the services sector is dominant. In our country, as you must be aware, services sector is contributing to the GDP by more than 54%. The industrial sector is contributing a nominal 20%. Even then, why are we always paying greater attention to the industrial sector, and why have we chosen today's topic to particularly focus on the industrial productivity in India? You are all aware that the potential of the agricultural sector in giving employment and generation of income to the people engaged in that is limited, and you are also aware that development is possible by focusing on the so-called industrial sector, and within that the manufacturing sector in particular. And what we do in the manufacturing sector will be taken to different points of consumption, and that is the role, that is the part where the services sector comes into being. Services sector mainly hotels and trade, restaurants, in which both the retail trade and the wholesale trade comes, and transportation, storage, defense services, all these type of services, by way of giving service of one kind or the other to the economy, contributes greatly. But if there is nothing by way of industrial production, then what is there to transport and what is there to distribute to other sections of the society? So it is in this context that after primary sector, which again depends upon the level of education of the population in the country. As you are aware, In our country, a large section of our population are dependent on agriculture, and they are mainly, nearly 40% of our population is even today in the illiterate section. So, as you move from the primary to the secondary sector, the educational requirement of people finding themselves engaged in that sector will increase. It is more in manufacturing sector, that is the industrial sector, as compared to the primary sector, and it is more in the services sector as compared to the industrial sector. Therefore, the emphasis that is given in terms of our policy is on industrial promotion, so that greater productivity by way of income earnings is also made possible to the people engaged in that sector, and it also gives us the required foothold to establish ourselves as leading competitors in the path of development in the international spectrum. So it is with this kind of a broad notion, broad policy vision in view, that the many 5-year plans that we launched right after independence gave importance to the promotion of industrial sector in our country. Because of this, you are aware once again that the country made significant investment to expand the public sector in our country. And the country also adopted the policy of promoting the small scale sector. And we adopted the policy of mixed economic policies, and therefore we also gave importance to the growth of the private sector. So both the public sector and the private sector continued to grow harmoniously, and this led to significant expansion of our industrial base in the first few planned decades after independence. In spite of that, we are also aware that the expansion of industrial sector did not take off as envisaged, and it had to be reshackled by way of renewed policy thrust that we accorded beginning with the 80s and then according a greater thrust to it in the 90s. So what I am trying to say is the industrial growth and thereby its contribution to the economic growth has consistently received continued support in our planning process. And it is given because the growth, the economic growth, is required to be suitably supplemented by the industrial output, and then giving a boost to the both the primary sector as well as the services sector. We are aware that agro industries, which depend for their raw material on the products of the agriculture sector, will also get a boost when we give a thrust to the promotional thrust to the industrial sector and also to the services sector. So with this brief introduction, let me now come to the main aspect of productivity, which has been taken as the central focus of our theme in this topic. Now, what is productivity? By productivity, it is simply meant that it is the ratio of output to input. There is an output which we generate, which we get, and as a result of any industrial activity or as any entrepreneurial activity, and a certain amount of inputs will go into its making. So if you take the value of the total output to total input, the indicator, the measure that we get is called as productivity. The emphasis here is for every one unit of input, we must be able to get optimum quantity of output. And if we are not able to get it, we must be able to focus on such areas which will contribute to its increase. So this is the underlying, you know, definition behind this productivity. And with this, we will continue to see how it will increase, how it will contribute to an increase in the productive performance of the economy in general and of the industrial sector in particular. So, by focusing on this, what happens is the competitiveness of the country, both in the domestic sector as well as in the international sector, will increase. So, this is what is going to pave the process of economic development into in the desired direction, and it is also going to give promotion to the export sector. And when with the export, we are aware that the balance of payments of the country also will improve. So these are some of the reasons why industrial productivity is accorded the required emphasis. And let us now see what is the fundamental thing that tells us that if we promote the industrial productivity, does it lead to the desired industrial economic growth? How is it possible, and what are the underlying factors that give it the required thrust? First of all, what happens by laying emphasis on productivity aspects, the cost of the products will come down, and with that the prices also will come down, and this automatically will generate greater demand both on the domestic front to begin with, and with the emphasis accorded to the export based products, in the international markets as well. So there is a competition which is induced, and the competition will ensure that there is better utilization of resources. Motivation or incentive is very essential, and if such an element is not there, adverse impact of the policies will prevail, and as we saw in the first few decades, that contributed greatly to industrial slackness. I will come to this point a little later. So what happens is, with the same investment, it will be possible for us to get greater output. That is the reason why emphasizing on productivity is going to contribute for attaining better industrial growth itself in general. And there have been various studies conducted both in the developing as well as the developed countries, which have established that productivity growth contributes to industrial growth. So these are some of the arguments which are advanced in order to as to focus on why productivity emphasis leads automatically to greater industrial growth. Now, as you know, traditionally we consider land and capital as two forms of input. These are two considered as the, in the classical scenario, land and capital were considered as the two factors of production. Now, while measuring productivity, if you consider either labor or capital singly, it leads to the concept of what we call as partial factor productivity. So if you take when we talk of labor productivity, we are considering only labor as the input. So if you take the total output, let me also say here that the output, I said productivity definitionally means it is the ratio of output to input. But if you do it in the other direction, suppose you subtract the input from the output, the resulting value that you get is called as the value added. It is called as the gross value added. And if another component, which we call as depreciation, is also subtracted from gross value added, what we get is the net value added. So when we talk of productivity, say partial factor productivity, labor productivity, we take in the numerator the value of output as measured by value added, which is output minus input. Taking that in the numerator, if you take the total labor that has gone into its making, that is the total employment, in the denominator, we get the ratio what is called as labor productivity. So in other words, it will tell us one unit of labor is able to contribute how much to the economic, to the national income of the country, to the industrial total output value of the country. Now, if you replace in the denominator, instead of employment, that is labor component, you replace it by the fixed capital that has gone into the total production, we get what is called as the capital productivity. So depending on whether you take labor in the denominator or capital in the denominator, we get two indicators of productivity separately identified as labor productivity and capital productivity. But we are aware that these are only partial factor productivities, and it is possible also, it is usually the case that the contribution of labor and capital
will not be with the same weights, will not be in the same proportion. Therefore, in order to get a meaningful measure of productivity, we should be taking what we call as the total factor productivity, in which in the denominator we are going to take the total input, both labor and capital, no doubt, but labor with all with what you know weight and capital with what weight. I will come to this point very shortly, but before that let us also try to introduce one or two more simple concepts. Capital intensity. So if capital per unit of output, you know, the capital intensity, when we say, we take actually the capital, fixed capital in the numerator and employment in the denominator, that is per employee how much capital is being invested. So if this ratio is taken, it will give rise to capital intensity. So we know that the same amount of production can be extracted by changing the proportion of factors, by making substitution between labor and capital, it is possible to get the same kind of this thing. But depending on whether we do with higher capital or with higher labor, we will be altering the extent of employment generated in the country. Whatever it may be, this substitution effect is going to contribute to our productivity measure, and in such a scenario, we ought to be making a distinction between what is the productivity part that accrues from the substitution effect and what is the productivity part that accrues from the efficiency. So when we say efficiency, it is the other side of the substitution effect, in which, you know, the various factors like better training that we can give, education through which skill can be imparted, all these factors are going to come, and we will be talking about this shortly. So labor productivity can gain due to various reasons, and in particular we have identified the two factors of the substitution effect, in which capital is substituted for labor, and the efficiency of the firm, which can be also realized by paying attention to various other factors as I mentioned. Now it is also very much the case that the factor substitution usually leads to both labor productivity and capital productivity moving in opposite directions. That is, if labor productivity increases, capital productivity may decline. So in this situation, it is not clear to us what exactly is happening to the composite factor of productivity that we are interested in knowing. In therefore, this introduces the need for considering a more composite factor of productivity called as the total factor productivity. So in this, we will be taking all inputs with due importance given to the weightage for each factor. So when we talk of total factor productivity, what we have to remember is, it is once again the ratio of output to input, but in the denominator, we are not exclusively paying attention to only one factor, either labor or capital, but we are taking both into account. This is the difference. So notationally, it is possible for us to look at this measure of productivity from this from these simple notations which I am going to introduce now. Let us take Y to indicate the total income. So in this particular case, the total factor productivity, we will be taking as a ratio of total income in the numerator and total value of the inputs that we take here. So this is the initial understanding that we require for this concept, and we will see how the productivity indicators are changed or developed further by making certain improvements in this. So in this expression, suppose you take logarithm on both the sides, then what we get is the log of TFP on the left side, and the right hand side changes from the existing ratio of Y divided by I to log Y minus log I. Let me take a logarithm here. You are all familiar with this concept, so this is helpful in getting the growth rate. So the ratio now comes to log y minus log I. So we are going to be now focusing on this factor,
and when we take the two factor case, we are obviously taking into consideration both the factors here. Look here, log y minus, I am opening the brackets now, and I will be considering the growth rate for which I will multiply. The star I am writing is the multiplicator sign, the growth rate of output, and there is a similar quantity here, capital, the weight part, and this will be multiplied by the growth rate in the capital. So in this measure, we are taking both the growth rate of labor, and that is employment growth rate or the labor contribution of the growth rate, and the capital, this thing, and we are multiplying both the things by its respective weights to get this single component, which is the total factor productivity given by the solo. I will come to this particular aspect very shortly, and this we will be referring, this equation we will be referring to it again and again. So I will call this equation as equation 1, and we will see, you know, how to now get the measures, two ratios, that is the WL and WK, which I have written. They are the two important things to get, and we need some basis, some rationale on which we will select this thing. And these, you are aware, these are going to be taken by considering the marginal products of the two factors of production. And ideally, if we are able to have access to the required data, we must be getting a measure which is equal to the marginal products of the factors of production. Now let me say in this at this particular instance that the industrial sector in India is divided into, is dichotomized into two broad sectors. One is called as the organized manufacturing sector, and another is called as the unorganized manufacturing sector. Let me say here that when we say industry, the industrial sector includes, in addition to the manufacturing sector, two other sectors. One is the construction, and another is the basic infrastructure, that is electricity, gas and water, which we call as the utility sector. This also is taken into account. So we will be, in order to calculate these values, the indicators of productivity, we will be indicating data on output and the various inputs. So these data are collected and published from several standard sources, and for the organized sector, we are having Central Statistical Organization bringing its bringing out annual reports, which are called as the annual survey of industries, and this focuses only on the organized sector in the country. And parallelly, we are having another organization, National Sample Survey Organization, which is conducting surveys on the unorganized sector of the economy. So when I say organized sector, what we mean is all industrial units, all manufacturing units, which are covered under the Factories Act, they are covered under the annual survey of industries, and they usually employ power in its manufacturing, and they employ 10 or more workers. There is another large sector called, coming under the unorganized sector, which deals with such factors of production, such units of production, in which less than 10% are involved. And these units are also trichotomized into three types of enterprises, and you will be benefiting from this kind of knowledge if you are going to be involving yourself in the act of, you know, this kind of measurement of productivity for different sectors. Otherwise, the units on the basis of which this particular session is being scheduled, is being talked about today, they are not giving you the details of these things, but I am sharing these details with you so that some of you, if you are going to be engaging yourself in the task of measuring productivity, you will be benefiting by knowing what are the sources from which you can lay your, which you can, from where you can take the data. So you require separately a measure, WL and the WK component. So there you are having data on wages also. For labor, the returns that he is going to get, the income share that he is going to get, is in terms of wages. So wages,
divided by gross value added is taken as a measure of weight for employment or labor, and the balance is taken as the capital. Now, if you take the balance, the entire thing for the capital, you are making a further assumption that you know the 2 adds to 1, the 2 weights add to 1. That becomes a very restrictive assumption, and we will see shortly how you know this these things are going to make up for the different assumptions that we make, and how the additional assumptions that we make, these assumptions that we make, it itself will be limiting the scope of that particular measuring index, and how one over the other goes on relaxing and improves it. So with this, one thing that is clear is, from the total value of output, you are taking out a portion, and what you get is, you are referring to it as the total factor productivity. That means the growth of total factor productivity that we are taking is a residual growth. So this is one important aspect. It is not indicated in the units which you will be reading, but total factor productivity growth is essentially a measure of residual growth. That this is one important point that I am trying to see. Now, the improvement in productivity itself can be brought about by various aspects. What are they? One is, the technology itself may go on improving. So due to purchase of plants and machineries, better materials and tools, it is possible to increase the productivity. It is also possible to focus upon the required training, that is education and training, better utilization of resources, cleanliness in the factory atmosphere. All these things are also going to contribute to productivity. So when we measure productivity, there are two components to it. One which is brought about by technological advancements, another which is brought about by pure technical efficiency. So there are two aspects to this productivity, and you must be in a position to identify which of these two factors have contributed to productivity. So this is a little higher order thing, and I will be coming to it very shortly. And there are certain situations where you will see that the growth rate of input itself is higher than the growth rate of output. Let us take, for example, the factors that are going to contribute for industrial sickness. Raw materials not being available, power not being available, that is the infrastructure sector not supporting it adequately, it is possible that we will be incurring more and more inputs, and commensurate with the inputs, our output is less. So the input growth can be higher than the output growth, in which case, if you apply this ratio, this formula, you will find that your total factor productivity growth will be negative. How do we interpret this negative growth rate? Are we meaning that technologically the industrial firm or the industrial sector is going backward, it is losing its steam, or it is not keeping up to the required this thing? It is not the case. What it means is, the firm is given the circumstances under which the firm is operating, it is not able to utilize its factors as efficiently as it was able to do in the past. That is the meaning with which you will have to interpret a negative growth in capital productivity, which is perfectly going to stare at you when you are going to be calculating it for industries. I will come to this aspect a little shortly. Now, let us see what is the underlying theoretical argument that is available in the literature on industrial economics, linking this total factor productivity with the production function. So we can imagine now that due to the technological changes, there is a production function, and the production function is going to shift depending on the technological incorporations that you will be making into your production system. So there is a frontier that is called as the production frontier, where if you use a particular amount of input with the given amount of technology, there is a potential output that you can gain, that is the highest that you can get. So on that production frontier, all the points that are there will be representing the maximum output that you can get by applying the you know, various combinations of inputs. There are various ways, various factor, you know, combinations by which you can get. So there is a maximum that you can produce and which is the optimum, but there will be several firms which will not be operating at that higher level due to lower capacity utilization, lower incentive to operate at that higher level. So what we basically will be getting from this production function is, you know, it's an equation or a graph which shows the relationship between the inputs used and the output obtained. You have already studied what is an isoquant. So isoquant is a curve in the input space, and you are aware that it is curved inwards, like the interior of a circle, it is curved inwards. So it will show all possible combinations of inputs which can produce a given level of output. So for every level, each level of output, there is an isoquant. So when we talk of technological progress, you can imagine that the isoquant will be shifting itself inwards. So the inward shift occurs because of the advanced technology which becomes possible, through which it becomes possible for the firm to produce more given the same level of input. So it is this shift in the production frontier or in the production function or the curve which we will be trying to capture by measuring this total factor productivity. So you can take the maximum possible output in the numerator and maximal possible output in the numerator and the actual output that you are producing in the denominator, and if this ratio is equal to 1, then you know that the firm is producing in its maximum efficiency that is possible. And if it is less than 1, then you know that there is some technical inefficiency and you ought to be focusing on how to identify them and how to be making improvements therein to improve your productivity. So lower this ratio, greater is the degree of inefficiency. Now you are again familiar, you are again here going to be hearing quite often another term called as the economies of scale. So in this, what it means is whether it is constant or whether it is, whether the output productivity ratio that you are calculating allows for a variable factors, you know, variable, you know, returns to the output, or do you have to assume the constancy. So when we say we assume constant returns to scale, what we mean is if both capital and labor inputs are increased by 10%, then output also increases by 10%. So whenever we say a particular measure of productivity, I will just come to it now, there is a solo index in which these two factors which we are seeing, that will be taking, it is limiting to 1. So if that is there, that means the assumption of constant returns to scale is there. So we are essentially trying to focus upon bifurcating or separating the effect to productivity, one measurable due to the technological advancement and another due to technical efficiency. Now with this, let us come to the various measures or the various methods that are there to measure productivity. There are two broad methods. One is called as the growth accounting method and another is called as the econometric approach. So the formula that I have just written now, it is very similar to what is developed by Solow to begin with. And this index, let us revisit this once again. So this factor, I can also substitute it by alpha, and this I can write as beta. So in this Solow index of productivity measurement developed by Solow in 1960, so the two weights alpha plus beta, this is necessary to be equal to 1. So if alpha is the income share of labor and beta is the income share of capital, the two are assumed to be equal to 1. So this unitary elasticity of substitution, this implies
that the income shares of labor and capital are going to be remaining constant. And now, to illustrate this with an example, if the wage rate goes up by 10, then we are saying this assumption of unitary elasticity automatically implies the employment will fall by 10. So you can see that this measure, although convenient to apply in practice, is having a strong assumption that is being made, and we are definitely in need of improved indicators which do not make this kind of rigid assumption. Now, also there is also one more assumption and one more term that we will be frequently coming across. Another assumption to be made that the technological progress is Hicks neutral. What we mean by this is that the marginal productivity of labor and capital rise proportionately. Such an assumption is also required. But now I come to another index called as the translog index, in which it is not necessary to make either of these assumptions. The unitary factor, the two weights which I have equated to unity here, which is equated to unity here in the solo index, that is also not necessary. And such an index developed is called as the translog index, and I will write the expression for that. So it is also a measure similar to what is written there, but the total factor productivity here is given by the growth rate of income in time t. I will now open the brackets and write here. So there is a time point t and there is a time point t minus 1. So you take both and divide both, take the average by dividing it by 2 and multiply this by the growth rate of labor in time point t. It is the same one here. So I have, you know, the entire thing is coming within a flower bracket, and you will have to do a similar calculation for the capital, which is in my expression SKT, SKT minus 1, the 2 added divided by 2, which I will be multiplying by the growth rate of capital. So this is called as the translog index. So what is happening is the basic variable. So you must be now trying to understand how this expression is actually calculated. This measure is called as the translog index because by taking logarithms to the series of income, capital and the materials, input and the output two separately, you are transforming them by logarithmic transformation. You are subjecting it into alternative quantities, different quantities, by which, by taking the difference, you can get the growth rates. We are assuming here two points of time, and this is important to be taken in this measure. So if you have the series of income, essentially for computational purposes, you will be following the following steps. You will first take the ratio of income yt at time point t and at time point t minus 1, and in the second step you will be taking its logarithm, and similarly you will be obtaining the ratio and the logarithm to obtain the growth in employment and income separately. And this the two factors, the growth rates obtained, you will be multiplying it by the respective weights that I have written here, and then we will be applying it in this expression to obtain an expression of the, to obtain the quantitator of the quantitative indicator of productivity. Now there is another possibility with which, you know, the availability of data for in the time series manner will help us to relax these assumptions and get a better indicator of productivity. That is possible if you are having time series data, and by time series data I mean for different years you are having
the required values of value added and, you know, employment, which is a measure of labor, and capital. If you have that, by running a regression, again you will be taking the logarithm of the values of income, employment, and capital, and you will be additionally introducing another factor. You will be taking another variable time for each year. For the first year you will take it as 1, second year you will take it as 2. Like that, if you are having data for 20 years, your t will be a variable running from 1 to 20. And that you will be having as one separate variable, and you will be running a regression of the form alpha, a parameter, multiplied by logarithmic values of L's, and beta, and logarithmic values of the capital, and a constant lambda multiplied by the time variable t. So if you run a regression now, the coefficient of t, that is the lambda, is going to give you a measure of total factor productivity. So if you are having time series data, in which in our Indian context, I told you earlier that for organized sector of the economy, we are having that kind of data, it is possible to use the econometric approach. And in this approach, you are not making any of the assumptions that we had to make in the earlier two formulas that we considered. So that way, for the organized sector, most of the studies that have been done in the Indian context, they have focused on the organized sector simply for the fact that the data availability for the organized sector is larger than it is for the unorganized sector. But this translog index that I have written here, it can be used even for the unorganized sector data, which is available on quinquennial basis in our country. So there are certain advantages of going for the econometric approach, and in spite of the advantages that it carries, there are certain limitations that are there for both the kind of, you know, this thing. And for example, you are familiar that in time series data, variables will be moving in same direction. If employment increase, if capital is increasing, employment will increase, output also will increase. In such a situation, the problem of multicollinearity will arise. So therefore, even though there is an advantage of going to the econometric approach, it is not possible to say, and the controversy has continued in the Indian context, whether the econometric approach will lead to better estimates of productivity, or the growth accounting measure, growth accounting indices will lead to better methods of productivity. Now the time has now come to wind up this session. There are other things which I could have shared, but the various studies which have gone into the measurement of productivity have brought out different sets of indicators, and there is no conclusive evidence coming out as to the productivity. If you compare it between the decades 70s and 80s or 80s and 90s, whether in one decade it has decidedly increased higher or it is decreased, this kind of a controversy has continued to remain. So in this session, we have focused on the industrial productivity in India, and we have looked at only one side of it. What is the definitional aspect, what are the data requirements, and what are the different indicators of measurement of productivity that are available. So these type of measurement will be useful to understand how the policies are contributing to increasing in productivity, and whether at all it is going in the desired direction or not. So these type of things, these are discussed in two units in your course on EEC 07, and if you have any questions, you will be able to address to us in the IDs that we have given at the end of the thing. And hopefully this session has helped you to get some additional understanding on the various aspects dealt with in those two units. Thank you.